before wading into the murky and turbulent waters of revitalization and restructuring, I felt a little bit of the turbulence yesterday, that which was spoken or unspoken. I believe it's important for me to name several presumptions that I carry within myself as I come to you these days. First, I presume that we are on the same evangelical adventure or journey together, the pursuit of the radical evangelical life. Second, I presume that we profess the same commitment to the development of our life with God, our life with our brothers, and our life as missionaries, that we are mission, as Pope Francis reminds us in Evangelii Gaudium, in service to the church and the world. Third, I presume that God is calling us to life, not to death. God is calling us to conversion, to renewal, to revitalization, and to embracing a future that will be radically different from the past or the present, because it embraces the fullness of God's vision for the life of the world, not our tiny and limited visions. Fourth, I assume that all of us have come to this meeting with open minds and hearts, and that all of us are committed to a process begun in its current form during and following the meetings in Milwaukee and Racine. I believe this process offers us the possibility of revisioning our lives as Friars Minor in the United States and the world, to re-energize our brothers, refound our fraternities, redirect our missionary efforts to embrace the world that is rapidly changing. One of the most difficult challenges, I think, has been to find ways of articulating these two necessarily interrelated processes. Revitalization, which is about values that lead to a mission, and restructuring, which are about processes that lead to new structures. To do this in a language that is intelligible, meaningful, and capable of generating energy, hope, and commitment to the core values of our Franciscan life and mission. As Jack Clark Robinson made it so clear in his double helix image shared with me and the members of the FIT team, the DNA of Franciscan life involves both content and form, stability and movement, imagination and structures. I might add that in the case of the emerging entities of the order, those that are experiencing numerical expansion, restructuring does not automatically imply revitalization. As with the gospel text from Matthew 19 that we heard yesterday, revitalization comes only to the degree that we make an explicit commitment to place God at the center of our lives, and to the degree that we commit to living with and for brothers in fraternity that are engaged in God's mission to the world, as Laudato Si, the encyclical of Pope Francis, reminds us, a mission that extends to the care and the protection of our Mother Earth, and also is a document entitled Itinerante, Guidelines for the New Forms of Life and Mission in the Order of Friars Minor. I'm sure all of you read that last night. It was published in Rome in 2014 by the General Secretariat for Mission and Evangelization. Seven core values are mined from the experience of members of new fraternities that have emerged in different regions in Europe, and which seek to propose the revitalization of the life and mission of the Order of Friars Minor today. For those of you who are members of the Province of Sacred Heart, you will recall in 2011 that I participated in a fishbowl experience where I shot down the idea, where I challenged the idea of creating these new fraternities. I stand on two things today. Number one, I recognize that these communities have and are making a contribution to the life of the order. At the same time, I still share the same conviction as I expressed there. These core values should be found present in every one of our fraternities, and somehow we need to find a way to be integrated into our experiences. But for those of you who were present in 2011, I've experienced a conversion of hearts, so take refuge in that. Let me explain or just list these core values of our Franciscan life and mission that are articulated in Itinerante. They include the following, and none of this is new. You know the five priorities. It's just stated in a different way. the primacy of life of prayer and of listening to the Word of God. This is what we know already to be true of our lives. Number two, care for the authentic and deepening of fraternal relations, which radiate a testimony of fraternal life. Number three, a simple and sober lifestyle, giving testimony to minority. Number four, welcoming and sharing our life with the people of God, and above all, with our brothers and sisters who are poor. Number five, evangelizing mission with a character of intergentes, itinerancy, being present in unknown, difficult, and risky areas, and demonstrating closeness to the poorest of the poor, to the suffering, and to the excluded through inserted fraternities. Number six, communion with the local church by giving testimony to our fraternity and our minority, and not simply filling posts that are needed in the local church. Number seven, our willingness to adapt and adopt forms of active collaboration with the laity and the Franciscan family. This document was written after Evangelii Gaudium, and it had that in mind, the renewal of the vocation of the laity for the life and mission of the church. To these seven core values, I would add an eighth, which finds expression in the lived experience of the writings of Francis of Assisi and in the recent apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, chapter 4, and in the encyclical Laudato Si of Pope Francis. And that eighth is commitment to the transversal values of justice, peace, and integrity of creation, and to working for the social transformation of the structures in society and the reconciliation and healing of the social and natural world. Yesterday, you brought up a question. What is the role of the Minister General and the General Definitorium in this process, this engagement upon which his journey, upon which you have embarked now for several years? I think that it's important to say that neither I nor the Definitorium can remain indifferent on the sidelines as you face and embrace the consequences of living the Franciscan charism in the U.S. today. As I mentioned earlier, we are not a federation. We are a universal fraternity, each responsible with and for one another. The General Definitory has by right and obligation the responsibility to accompany, control, encourage, and challenge you to seek new ways for revitalizing our presence in the United States and to all living as fraternities open to God's mission, which continuously challenges us to undermine all efforts to restrict our understanding and living out of the charism to the confines of our mental and geographical constructs. The General Definitory is required by the mandates of fraternal charity to accompany and to meddle in your business, since your business is our business and our business is your business. We're all in the same boat. We can't just throw out life rafts when we feel like when it's comfortable. We stand together or we sing together. What's at the heart of the matter is not where we live, but how we live. How we live in and for God. How we live with and for one another. How we live as mission and as missionaries to the world and to all of creation. In closing, I would urge you to spur the brothers in the respective provinces to seek new ways of living out our Franciscan evangelical charism here in the United States and to keep open your experience to the life of the order, the church, and the world. I urge you as leaders, and that is who you are, to lead, to stimulate the brothers to engage fully in the life of the fraternity, to deepen their life with God, and to expand their horizons of what it means to be brothers in the one universal fraternity. Yes, there are seven provinces, but there is only one fraternity. I urge you to speak the truth to the brothers and not to promote false ideas of what this process of revitalization and the potential for restructuring of the seven provinces might portend for their lives. Do not tell lies. Speak the truth. The brothers need to hear the truth. I urge each of you to do all you can, both individually and collectively, as the differentiatory of the seven provinces, to make visible and enticing the 7+1 core values of our Franciscan life, to model these in your relationships with one another within your respective definitories, and to challenge the brothers to pursue these values and not to succumb to the threats of individualism, isolationism, and the annihilation of the fraternity, a dangerous consequence of becoming a virtual person. I urge you to come to a new understanding of the historical heritage and beauty of your seven provinces, our seven provinces, in which history becomes prologue, setting the stage for the rich and enticing, exciting future that God is preparing for the fires and for the order in the United States. I urge you to get the fires moving again. We are members of a movement. We have not made that vow to Stabilitas Loci, but rather to Stabilitas Evangelicum, or whatever, however you want to best express it in Latin, if such a term exists. Our stability does not come from structures or geographical locations, but as we heard yesterday from Rob in his presentation yesterday morning, and something we know already to be true for ourselves, our stability comes from the enduring values of the gospel, expressed in those Franciscan values, expressed in the daily taking up the cross of Jesus and following in his footsteps. We are not called to maintain that which has served us well, but which for one reason or another might no longer be capable of serving us. We are called to reclaim the charismatic, itinerant nature of our gospel life, walking by faith and not by sight, nor by fear, nor by a false sense of historical security. Neither you nor I have the right to allow a province to choose death. We have only the obligation to choose life in whatever form that might need to take. Believe and trust in God's promise to be with you, to be with us always, even in the midst of diminishment, aging, and an uncertain future. Believe in the power of fraternity and the universal nature of our Franciscan charism that allows us, all of us, to recognize one another as brothers pursuing the same evangelical goals, values. Believe that the future is in God's hands and that God is calling us to step out of the same radical trust that Francis of Assisi and the early brothers demonstrated in their lives, a radical trust expressed in the lives of the great biblical figures of faith, Abraham and Sarah, Moses and Miriam, Mary and Joseph. Perhaps if for nothing else, some of your brothers here, even this time, you said, congratulations, thank you for serving as Minister General. I'm not sure what you're thanking me for. Are you thanking me because, not because I wanted to, but because I recognized that God was challenging me to do so? I had to leave behind my province. I had to leave behind my country, the usual structures in which I lived, in order to respond to what God was calling me to. I hope that's what you were thanking me for, and not thanking me simply because you're proud that there's an American or from Sacred Heart Province serving as Minister General. I hope that you are proud that you have a brother who models, not in all of my life, I'm a sinner worse than any of you, but who tries to believe in the promise that God has made. And that's what I challenge each of you to do. And I challenge the brothers of the United States to believe in the promise that God has made to us, not the promise of history. This is our future. Let us begin, brothers, for till now we have done little or nothing. Thank you for your kind attention.